أبدأ بسم الله الرحمن وبالرحيم دائم الإحسان.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم، أما بعد.
الحديث العاشر عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال: قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: إن الله تعالى طيب لا يقبل إلا طيبا، وإن الله أمر المؤمنين بما أمر به المرسلين، فقال تعالى: يا أيها الرسل كلوا من الطيبات واعملوا صالحا، وقال تعالى: يا أيها الذين آمنوا كلوا من طيبات ما رزقناكم، ثم ذكر الرجل يطيل السفر أشعث أغبر يمد يديه إلى السماء: يا رب يا رب، ومطعمه حرام ومشربه حرام وملبسه حرام وغذي بالحرام فأنى يستجاب له. رواه مسلم.
Another extremely important hadith that's emphasizing the importance of halal in one's life. That we all know that as Muslims there are certain things that are permissible for us to consume, and there are certain things that are not permissible for us to consume. And likewise, there are certain avenues of earning a livelihood and sustenance that are permissible for us, and there are certain things that are not permissible for us. For example, there are certain things that it's not permissible to be involved in business regarding. So you can't have a business where you are selling pork or wine. This is something that's not permissible for you to deal in. Likewise, you cannot be involved in interest-based transactions. And there is a stern warning to those who are involved in interest-based transactions. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam لعن آكل الربا ومُكِلَهُ وشاهديهِ وكاتبهُ. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has sent la'na on the person who consumes riba, the person who gives riba, the person who is witness to the transaction of riba, and the person who writes the riba and interest-based transaction down. And of course, all of these people are not the same in their level of sin. When it comes to the nitty-gritty of the issue, then of course, being on the receiving end of interest is a greater evil than being on the giving end of the interest. But this has its place, and it has its there are reasons for this, and this is just one example. There are many other things that it's not permissible for us to do, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in order for somebody's dua to be accepted, there is just one condition. The condition is that that person is trying his best to abide by the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is living this pure and halal lifestyle. So, one of the problems that we have today is many times parents, they complain that their children are rebellious and their children don't listen to what they have to say. So, of the many reasons why this happens, one of the greatest reasons is perhaps that household is not particular in what they are consuming or their sources of income, whether these are permissible sources or they are not permissible sources. And even the food that they are eating, are they particular about the food that they are consuming is halal? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it doesn't just say halal, He also says tayyib. So halal is one thing, tayyib is another thing. So halal, for example, that there are certain things, and this is a matter of taqwa. So there are certain things that if you ask a mufti, they will say that this thing is halal. But is that tayyib? is that pure, not necessarily always. So basically certain things can be halal shari'atan and haram haqiqatan. So haqiqatan, so an example of this would be, many of you might have read recent articles regarding where we get our seafood from in this part of the world, in North America. And many of the people who are on those boats catching that shrimp and that fish that we eat, a large portion of those people are actually slaves. So, you know, that is slave labor. So, whereas slaves have been outlawed, and that mechanism to outlaw slavery was always in place in Islam. So Islam, it was the common practice of people at that time to have slaves, but Islam always had that mechanism in place where it could do completely on its own without slavery. So that is why we see that for many sins, the expiation is to free a slave. That if you did this, the way to get out of that situation is you free a slave, and the freeing of slaves is something of virtue anyway. So you know, the freeing of a slave is a deed great in virtue, and no ruling in Islam is sort of tied to slavery. So that awareness or that mechanism was always in place to get rid of slavery. So today, when our seafood is being caught by slaves, so is that seafood permissible to consume? So the Mufti will tell you, yes, it is halal to consume that, because regardless of who is catching it, what really matters is what is being caught. But for the person of conscience, in their right, with a sound conscience and a sound mind, you wouldn't want to consume that seafood because it is being caught in an inhumane manner. Likewise, the treatment of animals in this part of the world, if you go to some of the slaughterhouses, the treatment of animals is extremely inhumane, which is something that's not permissible. But regardless of how that animal was being treated, if when it is being slaughtered, it is slaughtered in accordance with the laws of Islam, the Mufti will say that this animal is permissible for you to consume. It's permissible for you to consume. And whereas a person of conscience and taqwa knows the industry that this person is supporting, so perhaps that thing is halal, but it's not tayyib, it's not pure because of the actions that take place before that actual slaughter. So this is what some of the scholars might call halal shari'atan, but haram haqiqatan. Haram haqiqatan means that for a person of conscience, that thing would be regarded as haram because of the malpractices associated with that industry. So to the best of our ability. Now I know that all of us are not going to leave consuming meat altogether, but if we have options, and we do have options, we try our best to consume that what is tayyib and what is pure. And also our income is from sources that are tayyib and pure. So if you are a savvy investor and you have money put here and there, and you are interested in making money, there's nothing wrong with making money in Islam. But for a Muslim, a person of conscience, a person with the awareness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if he knows that where he is investing, these companies are supplying arms, for example, to people who are involved in genocide, or people who are involved in killing other Muslims or killing innocent civilians, then the person of conscience would not want his money to go to supporting those companies. So this all plays into that halal tayyib lifestyle, and this is something that we are obligated to try our best in upholding. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that there are many people, ash'ath aghbar. This is referring to a person who is on a journey, perhaps of jihad or hajj, that the person in his apparent state is that he is looking for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said his state is such that his food is haram, his libas is haram, means that these things were acquired with haram wealth, malbasuhu haram, he eats haram, فَأَنَّا يُسْتَجَابُ لَهُ. That if he's doing everything haram, and yet he's asking and he's raising his hands in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then فَأَنَّا يُسْتَجَابُ لَهُ. How is it that his prayers are going to be answered? So if you want your prayers to be answered, then you try your best to live a halal and tayyib lifestyle. Make sure everything that is coming into your household is halal and pure, is permissible according to Islam, and this will go a great way in many aspects of your life. For example, you a person who pays particular attention to his income and what he is eating, if it is halal and if it is pure, this person will have an increased concentration in his worship, and this is a matter of fact. So, you know, people who find it very hard to concentrate in their worship, regardless of what steps they take, then perhaps they need to analyze what exactly is going into their bodies, and do they need to make any changes in their sources of income and what they are consuming. And likewise, children, if your children are rebellious, if your children are not listening to what you have to say, if your children are not living the pure lifestyle that you wish for them to live, and yet you are feeding them haram on a daily basis, then perhaps you need to change what it is that is going into your children's stomachs. Now, yes. So tayyib would mean pure.
But the translation word unlawful, is it referring to the halal aspect, not necessarily the pure aspect?
Yes, it is referring to the haram aspect. But that is what I was speaking about, the pure aspect. That's a matter of our conscience and taqwa, that we should not be supporting things that that are oppressive to people or any creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes.
Alhamdulillahil qadim al-awwali al-akhir.